Has anyone had a chance to look at Rhythm Motion?
I know Russ has.
A little bit. Has anyone played with it?
Yeah.
Well, it's a lot of fun. I actually just started playing with it in the gym. So I had the time, but I was supposed to. Everyone else doesn't necessarily know. I only have a couple slides, but I also. All right. For those of you who don't know, are not familiar with it at all, it's essentially it's not exactly Ruby. It's a modification of Ruby. There's just a slight syntax difference between it and regular Ruby, which I'll show a little bit later. It's actually compiled, so it's not interpreted. You compile it, and it compiles apparently straight to machine code. I thought originally that it compiled to Objective-C, and then just use a compiler to go from there, but apparently not. Does, you know, automatic memory management, just like Ruby, everything you'd expect there. The coolest stuff about it for me, or I think, is the ability to integrate with third-party Objective-C libraries, all the other cool stuff that's already been done for iPhone, iPad. There's a lot of Ruby Motion gems, which will just take it, really make a lot of the things easier. Apple kind of made it a little tough with some of their conventions. And then sometimes you can use some pure Ruby gems occasionally, unless, as I said in the slide, unless they use a lot of kind of magic or defined method now exists, but you can't use anything that has eval in it. So anything with eval is not going to work. So why? First line there is the main reason. It's Ruby syntax is better than Objective-C syntax. So I'll go ahead and say that's a fact, but. Some might consider it bigger. Yeah. What if?
Your greater that needs to be bigger.
Yeah, exactly. No, but so anyway. Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
A little more true to the statement. So the rest of that stuff is just kind of silly bullet points, but obviously, you know, Ruby's awesome for object-oriented programming and just makes things a lot easier. You can really create objects so easy in Ruby, whereas in Objective-C, it's kind of a pain. And dynamic typing is available for everything, just like it would be for Ruby, which is pretty nice. I believe it has makes things a little bit slower, though. So Ruby wrappers, DSLs, there's even some Ruby wrappers that do similar to Active Record for managing data and saving it to the device. It's interactive. You can actually modify in a simulator. You can just choose a view and start typing to the left-hand side and start changing its position or modifying it on the live code. Do testing and debugging, as you expect. And no need for Xcode. Some people really like Xcode, but when I was using it, I ended up just crashing on me a lot. It just wasn't really nice. And the main thing for me was I was, for a long time, been looking for a good GUI for Ruby just to play around with, and I hadn't really found one. So I don't know if anyone's played with Shoes. Anyone tried? Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's actually nice. And I don't know, I'm assuming there's a lot probably to be done with JRuby, but I haven't played with that, so.
Not really from the GUI sense.
Yeah, not a whole idea, so.
You could use some Spring stuff.
So just before you get into anything, here's a quick syntax comparison. I don't know if it's easy enough to read.
We need to play on that.
Yeah, let me go full screen. So this is actually, so the Ruby Motion is the implementation of the Objective-C version. The things to really look at, so on a this minus symbol, minus sign right here, means that it is an instance method. Void, of course, is the return type. Set name is, of course, the method name, but it's actually not just the only part of the method name. The method name is actually set name and age. So even though it's split up here, this is the entire method name itself. Name is, of course, an argument, which is a string, and age is the other argument, which is an integer. So the difference in Ruby motion from regular Ruby that you see right away is with this set name method. It's trying to just duplicate it. Obviously, it could have been done different name however you want, but you see this and age. And so this is, in Ruby motion, also part of method name. You couldn't call set name without that and age part. So, and that's so you can essentially convert any Objective-C over to Ruby motion. And then the other thing is when you're calling things in Objective-C, they use these square brackets around everything. So UI alert view dot alloc for allocate is this method is being called on UI alert view. And so instead of using the dot syntax, they use a space and the two brackets, which gets kind of cumbersome when you start chaining a lot of things together. So I prefer the dot syntax a lot more. So something to show. So I put together a really simple Ruby Motion app. So you use Rate when you're working with Ruby Motion, which is pretty sweet. So you, just like you always would, you can see all the Rate options you have, things you can do. One you really use is Rate Build, or if you just run Rate. And I'll show you the code for this, but just to show it to you first. So it's pretty, it's actually an iPad, even though they don't show the outside of it. And it's outer space and a little spaceship here. And anywhere you click, the spaceship just kind of moves with your mouse, which would be touching, it would be a touch event. Just the iPad. It's not that impressive, and it actually, you know, it goes the same speed. The duration is what really matters. So if I go from here to here, it's going to take the same amount of time as if I went from here to here, which is, you know, probably not very suitable for a game or something like that. But that's the whole list, and that's what it does. All right. So
can you show the code for that?
Definitely. All right. So the code. So I built this to be as small as possible. Here's all the files essentially that make up the entire thing. There's four Ruby files here, which are the main majority of the code, which I'll show, and just these resources as well. All right, so the app delegate. This class is actually required for Ruby Motion, but more specifically for iOS development. So the app delegate's role is that it responds to events from the phone on the iPad, like hitting the home button while it's running or it initially launching and all that stuff like that. This method here, application did finish launching with options, gets run as soon as it finished launching. So all we do is, real simply, this is kind of boring stuff, but it's all necessary in the beginning. Setting up a new UI window, and what we're doing is we're initializing it with a frame. The frame is its x and y coordinates, and its width and its height. And in this case, we're just using the screen's facts, so 0, 0, and then the full width and height of the screen. The other important thing before you can really even get going is you need a controller that you need to create and associate as the root controller of a window. You only need one window unless, I guess, you're working with like some sort of app that actually communicates with another screen, and then you can have multiple window elements. But I've never done anything like that since. Oh shit. All right, I'm waiting. All right, so let me go real quick then. Main controller, you just create this is where everything's happening. This load view is called on the main controller when it's instantiated. So we set a frame for the main view. That's the same thing I just said earlier. And then I create a new universe, which is a special object that I created, which is inheriting from UI view. And then I'm setting that the controller's view to the universe view. Right, so this is where all the custom code comes in. All right, so universe. What is universe? Universe is inheriting from UI view. I'm overloading the initialize method on my super and everything, running the old one. And then I just create a new space background. So this is all the code that's taken here. Mostly everything is views, so UI view and UI image view. I have to go a little bit longer here. So we take UI image, grab the space.jpg, we save it as space image, and we initialize a UI image view with that image. We set the frame equal to frame that was passed in, and actually the reason I'm using self here is because of this super. Okay, this could easily just be frame for this one. And then finally, I'm adding to the universe itself, a subview, this space background. This is the background. I create a new array for the spaceships, and I create a new spaceship right here. In this case, there's only one. And I'm also passing the universe to the spaceship, and then you'll see that later. Here's the initialize for the spaceship. Takes in the universe, saves it as an instance variable. Gets the image, creates a new image view for its own spaceship. I also get the X and Y coordinates, which I just choose randomly based on the size I have to work with within the universe of the sentence. Size, this is the size of the actual image itself, the spaceship image. Use all that to set the frame of the view. Finally, I set how long it takes to travel. This is just between 1 and 1.5. And I add the ship as a subview of the universe. So where things get interesting is on the universe, this touches began. This is where I'm essentially capturing the onTouch event. Anywhere you touch, this is a method that is a part of UI view, so that's why it's inheriting it. And I override it, it's expecting to call it when you touch. So it calls, grabs the touch object, and it hits the location of the touch, which is right here. And then all I do is I say for each spaceship, tell that spaceship to move to this new location. And obviously, most of the stuff is happening here in this move method, where I calculate the new rotation, and then animate here to animate the turning to that new angle. And then there's a separate animation which animates actually to go into the location. They both run at the same time. So it's not like the second animation runs after the first one. So passing in anonymous blocks to do the animation as well as a block for completion, but nothing's happening. Now these things could be combined together. The only reason they're separated because this one happens in 1/4 the time, because it actually looks really silly if it takes the whole time to turn. So, but just to see. Alright, so obviously now it just looks like it's spinning out of control. Anyway. It's not very useful, it wouldn't be that fun of a game, but you can see kind of just how you can really place images around and animate them to build maybe other things besides this, like control systems and maybe some things like that.
Is it still a proprietary, you have to pay for?
Yeah, it's still $200.
Yep.
Yeah, it's not free, and you gotta pay Apple as well, about $100 too.
It's okay to pay the developer.
Yeah, that's true.
I'd love to see a half hour presentation on this motion.
Well, there's a hack night next week, 2 hours.
Let me tell it.
That's awesome.
Thank you. Joybox is pretty sweet. I've never used it, but I've actually looked at the documentation. It looks pretty awesome. It's Cocos 2D and Box 2D physics engine all wrapped up into one Ruby motion gem. Development pretty easily. And the other stuff there is just for building interfaces and modeling data. So
thanks, man.
Thank you.